Hello, everyone, and thank you for joining us for Quantum Today. I'm John Donohue, the Scientific Outreach Manager at the Institute for Quantum Computing. The IQC is a multidisciplinary research institute at the University of Waterloo, studying the potential and development of quantum information science. We have researchers working on the cutting edge of physics, chemistry, mathematics, computer science, and engineering. And during Quantum Today, we'll be looking closer at the research happening at the quantum level. Please do feel free to ask any questions in the chat box, and we'll get to as many as possible before wrapping up. Before we begin, we have a pair of short announcements. We will continue our panel series, Quantum Perspectives, on December 1st with a discussion on quantum simulation. How can programming quantum devices to behave like others help us learn about quantum mechanics? We'll chat with Professor Na-Young Kim, Dr. Alexander Cooper Roy, and Dr. Jinglei Zhang to find out then. We have also opened applications for the 2023 Undergraduate School on Experimental Quantum Information Processing. If you are in your undergraduate studies now and interested in diving into quantum information, please consider applying for this in-depth two-week summer school. Opportunities for summer research internships are also available when you apply for USQIP. To find out more, please check out the link in the chat or find it on the IQC website. Today, we'll be talking about skyrmions and quantum spin. One of the most fundamentally quantum properties an object can have is something called their spin. This property is quantized, and therefore information can be encoded in it, but it's also generally quite fragile. However, collections of spins may form structures that are less fragile and potentially even used as long-lived magnetic memories. Enter the magnetic skyrmion, a collective vortex-like structure of many spins. These skyrmions enjoy a special kind of stability known as topological protection, which makes them very attractive for storing information. However, finding the best ways to control and manipulate skyrmions is still an active field of research. The tools to measure these transitions also start looking a little exotic and might require a nearby nuclear reactor. In a recent result, a collaboration between researchers from the University of Waterloo, McMaster University, and the National Institute for Standards and Technologies, Gaithersburg, found pathways to manipulate the number of skyrmions present in a disordered sample, using neutron beam scattering to characterize their samples. Here to unpack this result with us is Melissa Henderson, a PhD student in Professor Dmitry Pushin's group at the Institute for Quantum Computing and the Department of Physics and Astronomy at the University of Waterloo. The result was recently published in Physical Review B as skyrmion alignment and pinning effects in the disordered multi-phase skyrmion material cobalt-8, zinc-8, manganese-4. Melissa, welcome and thank you so much for joining us today.
Hi, thank you for having me.
Well, it is absolutely our pleasure. So let's start at the very basics. Skyrmions relate to the configuration of spins inside a material. What exactly do we mean when we say spin?
Yeah, so as you alluded to earlier, spin is an intrinsic property of all particles. So it's known as its intrinsic angular momentum. And so as we know from a Stern-Gerlach experiment, it can assume quantized levels. And so in specific materials due to underlying exchange interactions, you can get different couplings between these spins. And these spins can in turn, yield exotic rotating spin textures, which are endowed with these topological properties. And so ultimately, spin are just moments arising from these unpaired electrons that can exhibit these unique couplings throughout magnetic materials.
Okay. When you said they kind of can exhibit these unique topologies, what do we mean when we say topology?
Yeah, so topology is a very mathematical word for a physicist. We like to translate things more so into energy scales and energy barriers. But essentially what one can think of in a very simple context is you can think of a balloon or a spherical cow. So you can think of trying to transition between two different topological states. So in this case, you're transitioning between the same topological state. And that is because you don't have to introduce any sort of discontinuity to transition between the two states. So two states are thought to be topologically equivalent when you can continuously and smoothly transition between the two. So for example, by transitioning from this balloon, you can shrink it into a cow configuration without actually having to introduce any sort of a hole or a topological parameter. So this endows your structure with a sense of protection when trying to transition between topologically trivial and non-trivial states. So for example, a skyrmion, which has a non-trivial topology, which essentially comes about in this winding character, it counts how many times it can wind a sphere. Mm-hmm. And so when you have this this topological parameter, you have to introduce some sort of a discontinuity to transition to a non-topological state. So what that translates into physically is an energy barrier. So it endows the state with some sort of an energy barrier, and therefore it's somewhat protected because you have to overcome that energy barrier in order to destroy the state. So that's a really intriguing property of skyrmions.
Okay. So in the analogy with the cow, the transition from the sphere to the cow would be considered, you know, we're not changing its topology at all. So that would be something where there'd be no energy barrier, correct?
Yeah, exactly. This would be a smooth transition. You don't need to introduce or overcome any sort of energy barrier. And in fact, this cow is topologically trivial. So we're not quite as interested in the cow as we are in the skyrmion.
Absolutely.
However, if we were to introduce a hole into the cow and create it into a donut or a torus, then we would be introducing some sort of a topological constraint. And then we'd have to introduce an energy barrier. And one could think of that as popping. That's the energy that you're providing to transition mm-hmm. between the two states.
Absolutely. Okay, so as you mentioned, we aren't really looking at sub-microscopic cows, but something that looks maybe a bit more like this. So these skyrmions, we're instead looking at is the kind of configuration of these spins. So what would be, you mentioned briefly the winding member. Can you explain a bit more about that? What exactly is a skyrmion?
Yeah, so for those of us who are familiar a bit with magnetism, one of the spin configurations we can think of that is the most easy to visualize is a ferromagnetic background. So in this instance, you just have all your spins perfectly collinear aligned parallel. And that's topologically non-trivial. There's no sort of winding texture to that. But with skyrmions, we have this winding from the periphery where we have the spins pointed up, and then they wind all to the core where they're pointed down. And there's a smooth transition between that. So that is that winding parameter. And if we were to try to map every spin direction onto a sphere, we see that every spin direction would actually cover the entire sphere because we're mapping every single spin direction as we wind. Versus if we were to consider the ferromagnetic state where they're all perfectly aligned and we were to map that to a sphere, that would just correspond to one point. So that's topologically trivial. We're not wrapping that entire unit sphere once. Okay. Where skyrmions would wrap that once, or an integer number of times. You can get to even higher topologies of 2 and 3 and 4.
Gotcha. So where it kind of covers the sphere in multiple ways, or multiple times. Yeah.
Yeah, depending on how high that order is, you can get a higher energy barrier, and it can become more protected and more states. But the interesting thing here with these two images is that skyrmions not only form in these two-dimensional topologically protected structures, they can also elongate into these tube-like structures and form mm-hmm. in 3D.
Okay. Yeah, so when I look at the image on the right here, we see this tube-like structure, and that's really kind of that same image that's on the left, but extended all the way down. So it's kind of going all the way through the material?
Yeah, yeah. So essentially, you can get these 2D skyrmion structures, which tend to form in thin film structures. Mm-hmm. And then you can get these 3D structures, which tend to form in lattice arrangements in bulk materials. So this just comes up due to the formation of the skyrmions is due to a competition between your ferromagnetic exchange, like I said before, and then something called a DM interaction, which actually favors perpendicular orientation. So it creates this kind of spin canting, mm-hmm. and that's that winding that we're talking about. Okay. So in bulk materials, you'll get a bulk DMI, and this will tend to stabilize these three-dimensional structures, which are thought to penetrate surface to surface in an ideal material that's completely defect-free. But as we'll get to in a second, that's never the case.
Yeah, we'll get to those defects in just a moment. But let's assume for the moment that we did have this ideal material and these skyrmions did fully penetrate. We do have this topological protection. It costs a lot of energy for them to change their winding number. What would be interesting about that? What are some of the ideas that people have for how to actually use these skyrmions?
Yeah, so when you have this additional degree of freedom known as topology, you can embed your interactions and your dynamics in a topological subspace, which can uncover new robust pathways that are less susceptible to noise. It's also skyrmions, they are nanometric sized, which means that we can have these really localized, small, controllable structures that we can use for high density magnetic memory applications. The topology allows us to encode the information of zeros and ones into a different degree of speedum, a different degree of freedom. Mm-hmm. So perhaps we can encode the presence or the absence of a skyrmion as a zero or one, and that would correspond to a topology of zero or one. or perhaps we can encode the bits of zero and one into the chirality, so the winding mm-hmm. direction of the spins. So it really opens up all these new pathways for which we can encode information into these different topological and quantum degrees of freedom.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So these skyrmions, these are, you know, we should be thinking about these as directions of spins inside a material. They're not something that we can, and as you mentioned, they're nanometer scale in size. They're not something we can measure with a microscope. So what can we do to actually measure or infer the presence or absence of skyrmionic behavior?
Well, and not with a traditional tabletop microscope, but I call it a microscope. So it's a type of microscopy.
Okay.
So there's traditionally three dominant types of visualizing or characterizing skyrmions. So this can be done in real space through microscopy techniques like Lorentz transmission electron microscopy. So you tend to fire and transmit electrons to material, and then based off their magnetic deflections, you can visualize these real space structures. You can also look at transport properties through their topological Hall effects. And then finally, you can look at them in Fourier space through scattering, neutron scattering effects. So these are the three dominant visualizations. The first two suffer drawbacks. So in the microscopy techniques, you tend to have to thin your samples because you have to be able to transmit completely. And when you're thinning your samples, you're introducing confinement effects and boundary effects, which fundamentally alter the behaviors of the skyrmions that you're wanting to look at. So it's hard to look at bulk behaviors. And then in transport phenomena, you're not directly visualizing any of the structures themselves. You're looking at commensurate dynamics. So that's where Fourier space techniques like neutrons come into play. And they're very ideal because neutrons, as we know, are electrically neutral. And so they're able to fully penetrate the material. And so this is the one technique where we're able to fully penetrate these bulk materials and get complete 3D visualizations of the textures.
Okay. If the neutrons are electrically neutral, like that makes sense that they would be able to penetrate the material, what is the interaction between them and the skyrmion that allows us to visualize them?
Yeah, so neutrons have a magnetic moment.
Okay.
So neutrons can actually, they can interact through all four fundamental forces. They have mass, they have a magnetic moment, they can interact electromagnetically. But in this case, we're looking at magnetic scattering between the magnetic moment of the neutrons and then the magnetic field created by the spins in the material.
Okay. So I have an image of kind of a simplified version of your experiment that you did in this particular result, where you're sending the neutron beam through the sample, imaging the Fourier transform effectively of that skyrmionic structure. Of course, this isn't as simple as it is in the real world. Are there any difficult things about generating a neutron beam or using the detecting a neutron beam?
Oh, yes. neutron beams. So we need to go to, there are two ways to generate a neutron beam. That's either through spallation processes, so firing highly energetic particles, liberating neutrons from material, or through nuclear reactors. So you'll produce neutrons as a byproduct of the decay, and then you'll moderate them to the energies you want. Yes, it is a very tedious and time-consuming process to produce the neutrons you want. But essentially, when you go to one of these beam lines, what you'll need to specify is the wavelength you want. So that'll help determine the dynamic structures that you're going to be probing, the distances you'll need to achieve that, and then the collimation, so how you're focusing your beam. Mm-hmm. So those are the main parameters that you can control for. And then you can include additional sample environments like magnetic fields and temperature and electric fields that you can stimulate your material while you're probing the neutrons through the material.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so we'll come back to those things that you use to adjust the material, the parameters you tune for the material in a moment. But I want to first talk a little bit about what you mentioned earlier about defects. So in your work, you purposefully studied disordered materials. First off, what do you mean by disorder, and what makes those kind of materials interesting for this kind of study?
Yeah, so there's a bunch of different ways in which disorder can arise. So you can think of disorder in terms of like polycrystalline disorder. You can have different crystalline domains in your material. You can also have just disorder inherent to the growth process. So whenever you're growing material, it's never going to be perfectly defect-free. There's always going to be some sort of a vacancy, maybe some impurity. But in the case of this material, its composition is inherently site-disordered, which means that there's a bit of atomic randomness as to what atoms are distributed on what atomic sites. So there's a bit of disorder introduced into the lattice as to whether you're going to have a cobalt, a zinc, or a manganese atom. Mm-hmm. And so what this does is that introduces slight variations in your exchange parameters. So you have a Hamiltonian that governs your system, and that's defined by your exchange interactions. You have some, perhaps some anisotropy, you have your DM interaction, and then you have your Zeeman term. And so when you're changing the different atoms randomly, you're changing these exchange constants. And so that can introduce nucleating and pinning defects. So these are the defects that we're alluding to in this material. So essentially, just because of that random distribution in atomic sites, you can get this random distribution in your exchange field, which leads to these singularities.
Okay. So we have these different singularities inside the material. And now, as mentioned, you're popping into this neutron beam and you're adjusting some parameters to try to see what changes in the material. What sort of parameters did you tune to reorient the skyrmions? And what evidence did you look for to show that you were truly actually manipulating that skyrmionic structure?
Yeah, so essentially those defects that I was talking about, they can randomly disturb the long-range ordering of the lattice, and so it can produce sort of like a jammed labyrinth state consisting of, instead of having these nice lattice-arranged ideal penetrating skyrmion tubes like we saw originally, you'll get these kind of zigzagging, merging, worm-like tubes that annihilate and then reintroduce, and they're all really disordered. Mm-hmm. And so what that would happen is, in if we go back to the SANS image, instead of having a really pretty hexagonal lattice, we're going to have a ring, because you're going to have this random distribution of scattering in all these different directions, because there's no set orientation of your lattice. It's a rotationally disordered superposition, and so it would smear it. So when we initially look at it, we see something that's a smeared ring. And luckily for us, we have a way of ordering the ring into these beautiful six-fold lattices. Froze a bit. Okay. So what we can what we can do is, in fact, someone has shown that you can rotate the magnetic field on the sample, and the skyrmions will follow the field, and it will actually pick up some of these defects, and it will try to order the skyrmions and create these nice hexagonal and long features. So one of the parameters that we tune is the rotation of the magnetic field on the lattice. Mm-hmm. And then another parameter that you can control for is your temperature. So as you scan through temperature, you're actually modifying those different exchange interactions. And so that's actually changing the phases and the lattice arrangements. And so we wanted to look at the interplay of the amount of disorder and how it's going to mediate these different transitions.
Okay. So what results did you find? Was there any way that you found that it differed from these defect materials, these disordered materials, from kind of the results that people take for granted in ordered isotropic materials?
Yeah, so there's a few different phases in a skyrmion material that have been well established for ordered materials. So you typically stabilize your material in a thermal equilibrium phase under some magnetic field, and then you can quench it and freeze in that order into a metastable phase. And then if you keep cooling even further, you can get a nice square lattice transition. And that's just due to the fact that as you continue cooling, it'll change your ratio of your exchange and your DM, which will mediate a different lattice reorientation from triangular to square. And so these transitions have all been well observed and characterized through both SANS measurements and through microscopy techniques in well-ordered prototypical materials. So what we wanted to do is we wanted to look at how introducing disorder would mediate these transitions, and if any of these transitions would in fact not be possible because the disorder inhibits it, perhaps. Mm-hmm. So maybe if we were to have a super disordered material in the thermal equilibrium phase and we transition all the way to the square, perhaps we wouldn't be able to get these reorientations to produce a nice square pattern. Perhaps we'd still have that ring-like pattern in our SANS measurements. Mm-hmm. And in fact, this is not what we see. We see that we're actually able to precipitate some order when we convert from our thermal equilibrium down to our square lattice. So we actually end up going from a ring-like to a more square-like pattern.
Okay.
And we have simulations which suggest that this is due to a change in topology of the skyrmion tubes, wherein they have to merge and separate in order to reorient into that square pattern.
Okay. If the topology is changing, does that have any implications towards, you know, kind of what people think about in terms of the topological protection of these skyrmionic of these skyrmions, or is that still consistent with them being topologically protected?
So it was previously thought that during these triangular square lattice transitions that the skyrmion number is conserved. So that means that if you're in the triangular lattice and you have 100 skyrmions, then you're going to have 100 skyrmions in your square lattice and nothing's going to change. But in fact, our simulations and our same measurements suggest otherwise. It suggests that you actually have to change the number of skyrmions in order to reorient into the square lattice. It suggests that you're starting with, let's say, 100 skyrmions, and maybe you're going to 150 as they're separating and segmenting so that they can order into a square lattice. So that is quite contradictory to the previously held belief that skyrmion number is conserved when you're transitioning between two different lattice forms.
Fascinating. We do have one question in the chat from Rabiel. Could you please comment on what values for exchange energy and the DMI value you used in your simulation? How were those obtained?
Oh, yeah. So we used those parameters from previously determined experimental values in other papers using spin wave spectroscopy. You can probe the different exchange and DM parameters. So those were confirmed from previous experimental reports.
Awesome. So with kind of that somewhat contradictory finding coming out, what are some of the next steps for this project? Are there any open questions that beg to be tackled?
Yeah, so one thing that we'd really like to look at is we'd like to be able to three-dimensionally visualize these skyrmions as we're undergoing these different ordered and disordered transitions. So the technique that we used currently, the small angle neutron scattering, it's an averaging technique. So it just gives you one 2D image averaged over the entire bulk of your sample as the neutron is going through the entire sample, averaging over these interactions and producing this commensurate image. So we're not actually able to internally visualize these 3D tubes like we are with microscopy techniques. So one thing that we want to do and one thing that we've developed is a tomography technique. Mm-hmm. So you can actually rotate your sample and collect different azimuthal projections. Mm-hmm. And then you can input that into a reconstruction algorithm, which would then generate actual 3D images of your skyrmion tubes. And so if we were able to visualize these three-dimensional tubes and characterize them through these disordered and ordered transition pathways, then it would give us great insight into the underlying mechanisms for skyrmion topological transitions and their stabilization. And then we could perhaps have new routes of controlling skyrmions in the bulk for practical applications.
Gotcha. All right. So you'd be looking at kind of, instead of looking at a 2D momentum space slice, you'd be looking at kind of a full 3D reconstruction of that space and what I imagine is a pretty hefty processing step after that.
Yeah. So you'd be looking at 3D real space structures like we showed at the beginning, where you'd see those tubes in real space. And yeah, so we've actually developed the technique and we've characterized it on an ordered thermal equilibrium state. And it can take a day to reconstruct. And then you need some other external parameters from like some susceptibility measurements to also seed the reconstruction. So it's not trivial. Mm-hmm.
So these experiments are absolutely never one person experiments. You have collaborators in, for example, Nis Gaithersburg from McMaster University. What mix of expertise is necessary to bring a project like this together?
Yeah, so when dealing with quantum materials, your first step is always a materials growth lab. So for that, we went to McMaster University and the Brockhaus Institute for Materials Research. There's some great people there, and they helped us grow these site-disordered materials, and that's always a time-consuming process. First, even confirming that you have a skyrmion material to begin with before going through the arduous process of submitting a proposal to a neutron facility to then test what you actually want to test. So people in Master are invaluable to these experiments. Then, as I mentioned, the next step of actually performing the neutron experiment at NIST, you need these crazy beamlines with ridiculous infrastructure and million-dollar equipment that is inaccessible anywhere else in the world. And you need people with expertise in how you can manipulate these neutron beams to get what you want. So that comes down to the people at NIST. So Marcus Bull, Benjamin Heacock, and Michael Huber are the three people that that really helped us out with these experiments. And then, of course, at Waterloo and the Institute for Quantum Computing are where our ideas come from. We think of the ideas and we want to execute these projects. And then it trickles down to all of our other collaborations. So.
Awesome. Melissa, thank you so much for chatting with us about skyrmions. I feel like I learned a lot. And yeah, hopefully we'll have you back on to talk about 3D reconstruction before too long.
Yeah, thank you.
Our pleasure. As a reminder, thank you to everyone who tuned in today. We will be having another panel on quantum simulation on December 1st. And also, please do check out the Undergraduate School on Experimental Quantum Information Processing if you're interested in visiting IQC and if you're in second or third year, fourth year of your undergrad. With that, thank you so much. Please tune into our channel, subscribe to our channel to learn about more upcoming events. Thank you for tuning in and have a wonderful afternoon. Thank you so much, everyone.